I want to welcome everyone. My name is Eric Bierbaum, Departments of Government and Social Studies, and on behalf of Michael Frazier, my co-convener, Harvey Mansfield from the Program of Constitutional Government, I want to welcome you to this event, co-sponsored by the Program of Constitutional Government and the Harvard Political Theory Colloquium. It's really a pleasure to introduce Alison McQueen. She's a political theorist at Stanford who works, at the interstices of political theory, but also has collaborated recently with comparativists, with methodologists. You've seen the title of her book, of which this is from, Political Realism in Apocalyptic Times, and she has other papers showing her range, a groupthink perspective on the invasion of Iraq, and she's now thinking about compassion and tragedy in aspiring society. This is her response to Martha Nussbaum's Political Emotions. She names her paper here from Cromwell, At the Edge of Promises and Prophecies, and she's offered to speak for around 30 minutes, and then
30 we'll have to 35 minutes.
An exchange till 6 o'clock. So welcome, Alison.
Thank you. So first I want to thank everyone for coming today. And in my remarks, I'm going to make the case that reading Thomas Hobbes against the backdrop of the apocalyptic expectations of 17th century England challenges conventional readings of Leviathan, but also prompts us maybe to approach Hobbes's work in a new way. But because this work on Hobbes is drawn from a book manuscript, as Eric mentioned, provisionally titled Political Realism in Apocalyptic Times, let me begin by saying a little bit about that larger project. Now, the book examines how three thinkers who are generally taken to be canonical political realists, Niccolò Machiavelli, Thomas Hobbes, and Hans Morgenthau, responded to outbreaks of apocalypticism, or hopes and fears about the imminent end of the known world. I should say at the outset that I take political realism to be a distinctive family of approaches to the study, practice, normative evaluation of politics that tend to affirm the autonomy, or more minimally, the distinctiveness and contextual specificity of politics, that take disagreement, conflict, and power to be ineradicable and constitutive features of politics, that reject as utopian, moralistic, perfectionist those approaches which seem to deny these facts, and that prioritize the requirements of order and stability over the demands of justice. Now, all three of the thinkers covered in the book wrote during times in which powerful political and social actors were publicly announcing the imminent end of the known world and defending political actions to be taken on the basis of those beliefs. And so tracking and evaluating the responses of Machiavelli, Hobbes, and Morgenthau to these contexts not only gives us, I think, a more nuanced understanding of the circumstances under which some of their paradigmatically realist arguments developed, and in some cases were eventually abandoned, but it also offers us a series of considered reflections on the question of how best to respond to public uses of apocalyptic imagery and rhetoric. Now, the book's analysis of the three thinkers identifies two strategies of response to apocalypticism. The first is what I call rejection, a principled turn away from apocalypticism and toward a tragic worldview. And that's the approach taken by Machiavelli in his later work and Hans Morgenthau in his earlier work. The second response is what I call redirection, an attempt to draw on the rhetorical, visual, and imaginative resources of apocalypticism to combat its worst excesses. And this is the tack taken by Morgenthau in his later writings, and I suggest by Hobbes in Leviathan. And it's to Hobbes's strategy of redirection that I'd now like to turn. So this will be a sort of highlights reel of the paper. Recalling the circumstances of his birth, Thomas Hobbes wrote that his mother, quote, brought forth twins to birth, myself and fear, at the same time. His premature birth on April 5th, 1588, was caused, Hobbes claimed, by rumors of an approaching Spanish armada that was, quote, bringing the day of doom to our race. But the advancing Spanish fleet wasn't the only reason to expect a day of doom. The year 1588 had been the focus of apocalyptic expectation and terror for over a century. Now, one prominent 15th century prediction held that if this year total catastrophe does not befall, if land and sea do not collapse in total ruin, yet will the whole world suffer upheavals, empires will dwindle, and from everywhere will be great lamentation. End quote. Now, during the course of Hobbes' life, there would be an explosion of apocalyptic prophecies. Prophecies that drew on the accounts of the end of the world offered in the biblical books of Daniel and Revelation. And these prophecies tended to impose a particular kind of narrative plot on the events unfolding in the England of Hobbes' day. A plot that cast the crises of the present as the suggestive signs of a looming final battle against the forces of evil. A plot that saw world-shattering violence as a necessary prerequisite for salvation and renewal. And a plot that saw England as the site of a new Jerusalem that would be established when the dust of battle had settled and the damned condemned to hell. Now, the question I want to think through together today is, how does our understanding of Hobbes' work change when we consider it against the backdrop of this apocalyptic context? Now, there is, of course, a conventional understanding of Hobbes, one I hope that few of us in this room have much truck with, but is still popular in philosophy circles and among game theorists, as well as in undergraduate survey courses. And that conventional understanding of Hobbes is as a thinker whose account of political obligation starts with broadly realist, some might say pessimistic or complacent, premises about human nature. That we are fearful, that we're instrumentally rational, that we're egoistic beings. And on the basis of these premises, then constructs an account of how free and equal humans of this kind might rationally come to subject themselves to a virtually absolute sovereign, a unified and unlimited sovereign whose formidable coercive power makes enduring forms of cooperation and rational obedience to laws possible. Now, I'll make the case today that the climate of 17th century apocalypticism shaped Hobbes' later work, and Leviathan in particular, in ways that challenge that conventional portrait, and that I hope offer us a more interesting and complete picture of Hobbes. Now, while there's been a substantial amount of work and scholarship focused on Hobbes' understanding of the political implications of religion, as well as the personal beliefs that may be inferred from his religious and scriptural arguments, Hobbes' engagement with apocalypticism remains, with a few partial but important exceptions, profoundly underexplored. And I'm going to suggest that attending to that apocalyptic context and to Hobbes' responses to it is at once essential to understanding the often unfamiliar and to contemporary eyes quite peculiar parts of Leviathan, the detailed scriptural arguments in the second half of the work, but also essential to grasping some of the deeply polemical and rhetorical ways in which he makes his more familiar arguments in the first half of the work. Now, I want to defend three claims. The first claim is a contextual claim, and the latter two are textual. The contextual claim is this. While English Protestant apocalypticism had been an important legitimating tool for kings and church authorities in the 16th century, by the 17th, it had become a serious threat to sovereign power and civil peace. It was precisely the kind of threat that a thinker like Hobbes had cause to worry about. And I'll argue that Hobbes responds to this threat not by treating apocalyptic expectations as marginal or by merely condemning them as foolish, but by redirecting them in the service of sovereign power and civil peace, that he fights apocalypse with apocalypse. And he pursues two paths in this project, one that is an overtly scriptural path and another that is seemingly secular. His scriptural argument takes aim at both the conveyors, the self-proclaimed apocalyptic prophets, and the content of apocalyptic prophecy, and ultimately offers a deflationary reinterpretation of the Christian account of hell and damnation. His secular political argument, I suggest, borrows from the narrative and rhetorical power of English Protestant apocalypticism, casting the chaos and violence of the state of nature as a necessary prerequisite to an enduring commonwealth ruled by a mortal God. Now, not only does this analysis offer us, I think, a new and perhaps in some ways unfamiliar Hobbes, but it also raises larger questions, I think, about how best to respond to hopes and fears about the end of the world, as well as to the crises and catastrophes that incite them. So let's begin with that contextual claim. After England's break with Rome in the 1530s and throughout the conflicts that ensued in the aftermath, apocalypticism provided resources to forge a new Protestant identity in England and to legitimize political and religious authorities that were no longer sanctioned by the Pope. And the chapter that was pre-circulated goes into some more detail about this. But what emerges in the 16th century is a Protestant apocalypticism that casts Protestants as the inheritors of the true apostolic church, and that casts the church in Rome as the false church, as the synagogue of Satan, as one English writer would put it. It's an apocalypticism that casts the institution of the papacy and even the Pope himself as Antichrist. And it's an apocalypticism that casts English Protestant rulers like Elizabeth I as godly princes who will defeat the forces of Antichrist and initiate the end of days foretold in Revelation. Now, these ideas were circulated in widely read books like John Bale's Image of Both Churches, 1547, John Fox's Acts and Monuments, 1563, and also in the Geneva Bible, 1599, well, parts of it come earlier, a mass-produced and tremendously popular Elizabethan study Bible whose marginal annotations on Revelation clearly link the Pope with Antichrist. But it's noteworthy, I think, that these works were cautious about encouraging their readers toward enthusiastic and politically radical attempts to initiate an apocalyptic transformation themselves. Instead, they urged their readers to sit tight, to leave matters either to God or to their godly princes. So while authors like Bale and Fox and the translators and annotators of the Geneva Bible had attempted to avoid encouraging dangerous forms of religious enthusiasm or political radicalism, their works would provide the theological fodder for the radical apocalypticism of the English Civil War. So how did this happen? How did the comparatively moderate Protestant apocalypticism of the 16th century become the radical apocalypticism of the 17th? Now, I think at least part of the explanation rests with England's changing political circumstances. So let me briefly mention two such changes. First, after Elizabeth's death, faith in the possibility of a godly prince who would overthrow the forces of evil and Antichrist started to fade. Now, things started well enough with Elizabeth's successor, James I, who seemed to really have all the right Protestant apocalyptic credentials. He'd written a commentary on the book of Revelation that identified the Pope with Antichrist and that prophesied the imminent overthrow of Catholic nations. But the political decisions he made during his reign did little to satisfy popular apocalyptic hopes. He sought peace with Spain. He was reluctant to intervene on the Protestant side in the 30 Years' War, and he proved almost as hostile to Puritans as he was to Papists. And his son and successor, Charles I, was even worse. He married a Catholic. He supported a faction in the Church of England, which promoted religious ceremonies widely seen as popish. So with their hopes for a godly prince dashed, radical Protestants in England, even some not-so-radical ones, began to focus on Parliament, or even on the community of believers at large, as agents of apocalyptic transformation. So the alliance between apocalyptic hope and monarchical power had dissolved. Now, a second and related change concerned the identity and location of Antichrist. During Elizabeth's reign, the identification of the Pope with Antichrist served the interests of sovereign power. It unified England against a common papal enemy, Spain. Now, in his commentary on the Book of Revelation, James I had identified the Pope with Antichrist and had argued that papal attempts to meddle in the secular jurisdiction of kings were evidence of this anti-Christian alliance. For those of you who are lovers of old pamphlets, there's a great pamphlet from 1611 with a wonderful image of the Pope riding the seven-headed beast of Revelation and telling some onlookers, "You are traitors, go kill your prince." Now, when he became King of England, James soon realized that he'd put himself in a bit of a difficult spot. It was hard to argue against those who criticized his peace with Spain or his failure to intervene on behalf of Protestants abroad, because these critics were merely demanding action against the Roman Antichrist. Now, James himself seems to have realized this and sort of backed off some of his earlier inflammatory arguments. But once again, things got dramatically worse under Charles I. The Church of England under Archbishop Laud was widely seen by its opponents as popish. Charles I as head of the church, and a king with a Catholic wife was also increasingly cast as popish and anti-Christian. Now, since the Pope was Antichrist, argued some Puritans and religious and political radicals, so too must be his agents in England. No longer safely abroad in Rome, Antichrist was now at home in England. Sovereign power had been undermined, and disobedience had become a religious duty. Now, while this apocalyptic message circulated among learned students of scripture, with the breakdown of censorship in England in the early 1640s, these ideas also came to penetrate the popular and political consciousness of England. So there's an incredible explosion of popular apocalyptic prophecy in this period. And from the late 1640 onward, apocalyptic preachers also held the ear of Parliament. The House of Commons invited preachers to preach in Parliament and eventually instituted a program of sermons on days of fasting. Now, most of those who preached before Parliament offered an apocalyptic interpretation of England's recent political and religious unrest. So Stephen Marshall, a Presbyterian churchman who was repeatedly invited to Parliament and could always be depended upon to say inflammatory things, warned of dangerous times ahead. Quote, "Little quiet, I fear, is to be expected in Christendom till the beast his kingdom be ruined," end quote. And in a later sermon, he urged God's soldiers in Parliament to be unflinching in their use of divine violence. While they may be inclined to think it barbarous, they must be willing to, quote, "take the little ones upon the spear's point, to take them by the heels and beat out their brains against the walls," end quote. Now, Parliament continued to invite Marshall and others like him to preach to its members. Parliament officially thanked them, and Parliament often published their sermons. And Marshall's own ideas were widely disseminated as fodder for the parliamentarian cause and were cited by captured soldiers explaining why they had taken up arms against their king. And the political use of these apocalyptic ideas persisted through the Civil War as those on both sides accounted for their actions with reference to Revelation. Oliver Cromwell would justify his own power in apocalyptic terms, allying his enemies with the forces of evil. But in the kind of ironic twist that is all too common in apocalyptic politics, Cromwell himself would eventually be condemned by his enemies as the beast of Revelation, and therefore as the target of legitimate resistance. So once again, apocalypticism refused to remain safely in sovereign hands. Now, what did Hobbes make of these developments? We know that he kept a close eye on the unfolding political situation, and that when some members of Parliament began denouncing monarchical books, he fled to Paris in November or December of 1640. But he monitored events in England very closely during his exile. We know that the young Prince Charles visited him in the spring of 1646 with news of how religious ideas were being used to justify rebellion against the king. And a little more than 8 years into his stay in Paris, Hobbes would have received news of the execution of Charles I on January 30th, 1649. Certainly by the time he did start writing Leviathan, the religious enthusiasm and radical apocalypticism of the English Civil War could not have been dismissed as a fringe phenomenon. And I think this may go some way to explaining two things. First, it may explain why Hobbes devotes so much of Leviathan to scriptural and religious questions. Half the book, compared to 3 of the 29 chapters in Elements of Law and 5 out of the 18 in De Cive. Second, it may explain why he devotes so much of that scriptural analysis in Leviathan to questions of Christian eschatology or doctrines of the end times. Now, Hobbes's scriptural response to the apocalypticism of the English Civil War is idiosyncratic and complex. He combats it not by trying to escape it or by merely condemning it, but by attempting to put it back in the service of sovereign power and civil peace. And he proceeds by three lines of attack. The first takes aim at the conveyors of apocalyptic prophecy, and the latter two at its content. So I'll point briefly to the first two lines of argument, and I'll dwell slightly longer on the third. Hobbes's first line of argument isn't aimed at apocalypticism specifically, but at prophecy more generally. He recognizes that the self-proclaimed prophets of his day play on a natural human anxiety about the future. And they often do so successfully because they can offer their audience not only a captivating vision of the future, but also a compelling performance of prophetic inspiration, capable of provoking belief and securing adherence. Now, the problem, of course, is what these compelling prophets ask of us in the name of the future and of God may be contrary to what our sovereign asks of us in the way of obedience. And Hobbes calls this problem of divided allegiance, quote, the most frequent pretext for sedition and civil war in Christian commonwealths, end quote. Now, Hobbes deals with this problem in part by systematically deflating prophetic claims to divine inspiration. These are some of the, you know, most amusing bits of his argument. So, for instance, to the prophet who claims divine inspiration through a dream, Hobbes responds, quote, to say he hath spoken to him in a dream is no more than to say he dreamed God spake to him, which is not a force to win belief. And Hobbes also offers concrete tests for genuine prophecy that no self-proclaimed prophet of his time could have actually met. Now, beyond his attack on the conveyors of prophecy, apocalyptic and otherwise, Hobbes also attacks the content of that apocalyptic prophecy. One line of argument that I won't discuss here, but we can discuss together afterward if you like, redefines the criteria of candidacy for being identified as the Antichrist. And if successful, that redefinition would not only exclude the Pope, the King, the leaders of the Church of England, it would also exclude virtually all other candidates for Antichrist, thereby making accusations about the identity of the Antichrist essentially politically harmless. Now, Hobbes's third, and perhaps most interesting, certainly his most unorthodox scriptural response to apocalypticism, is an attempt to redescribe the Christian account of hell and the end of days. Now, apocalyptic prophets held sway in Hobbes's time, not only because they were inspiring dramatic performers who held out the promise of a glorious millennial future, but also because they wielded the threat of eternal damnation. Failure to participate on the right side of the apocalyptic battles of the end times, they warned, would ensure one a place in the fiery depths of hell. Now, that's indeed a menacing threat. For his part, the worst threat the sovereign can make is to punish disobedience with mortal death. And when the dictates of those threatening eternal damnation conflict with those of the sovereign, who can only threaten death, it isn't clear that the sovereign is going to triumph. For as Hobbes puts it, quote, no man can serve two masters, nor is he less but rather more a master, whom we believe we are to obey for fear of eternal damnation, than he whom we obey for fear of temporal death, end quote. And Hobbes recognized that this imbalance of threat lay at the origins of the Civil War. Now, it's hard to overestimate the importance of this problem for Hobbes's political philosophy. The fear of mortal and violent death is the primary passion inclining men to peace, and therefore to the acceptance of and obedience to sovereign authority. The problem, though, is that death isn't the only object of human fear. We also have religious fears, or fears of things invisible, fears of darkness and ghosts, as Hobbes characteristically puts it. And at several points in Leviathan, Hobbes admits that these religious fears may sometimes be our greater and more powerfully motivating fears. So we're back to the familiar problem of divided allegiance. Do I obey the prophet telling me that I must participate in a final and decisive battle against evil or suffer eternal damnation? Or do I obey the sovereign's laws on pain of mortal death? Now, Hobbes had dealt with this problem in his earlier work by arguing that, properly understood, the dictates of faith coincide with those of reason and the requirements of salvation with those of political obligation. It's certainly convenient, if true. These arguments persist in Leviathan, but perhaps because he's now convinced that there were a number of religious radicals and others who were unlikely to be persuaded by these arguments, Hobbes deploys a new strategy in Leviathan. He offers an unorthodox and mortalist account of the Day of Judgment that denies the possibility of a Christian hell and everlasting torment. It also, and I don't talk about this in the chapter, he offers us a more prosaic account of heaven and salvation as sort of not all it's cracked up to be. But according to Hobbes, we will all die a corporeal death. Upon Christ's return to earth, our bodies will be resurrected, we will be judged. The righteous, as he puts it, shall have their bodies suddenly changed and made spiritual and immortal. However, contrary to what Christian scripture suggests, the sinners will not be subjected to eternal torments. Their punishment is simply to undergo a second mortal death. Now, what about all that wailing and gnashing of teeth that scripture tells us we're going to be condemned to in hell? That sounds an awful lot like terrible torment. No, Hobbes explains, these are just biblical metaphors, as he puts it, for, quote, a grief and discontent of mind from the sight of that eternal felicity in others, which they themselves, through their own incredulity and disobedience, have lost, end quote. So we're sad that we don't get to live forever and that others do. Now, what about those biblical references to everlasting fires and torments? This is a bit more troublesome for Hobbes. And he responds that the fires of hell are everlasting because there will be a perpetual supply of the damned. He makes the unorthodox argument that the damned will continue to propagate after the resurrection. Presumably, they have some time to kill while waiting in line for the final judgment. And he argues that the children that result from these encounters will likewise be damned. In short, scriptural references to everlasting torments are not meant to suggest that the punishment of hell is everlasting for any particular person, but rather that the generations of the damned will be perpetually replenished and will stoke its metaphorical fires eternally. So in promising us merely a second death rather than everlasting torment, Hobbes attempts to remove the threat of eternal damnation from the arsenal of those who would urge us to act against our sovereign in the name of an apocalyptic faith. Now, I think there's a lot that's scripturally questionable about this line of argument, but we'll put that aside for the moment. I think, still, the best that can be said for it is that if successful, Hobbes has only leveled the playing field between prophets and preachers on the one hand and the civil sovereign on the other. Both are now only capable of threatening death in exchange for disobedience. So on the best reading of this argument, Hobbes is back in a position which he has consistently tried to avoid, one in which the godly and the sovereign can make equally threatening claims upon us. And I'd suggest that his reason for persisting in this dubious line of argument, though he abandons some important parts of it in the Latin Leviathan, is not primarily because he finds it logically or scripturally sound. I think his reasons for persisting with it are because of the importance of the polemical intervention that the argument makes possible. If there's something we fear more than mortal death and we're willing to act on this fear, what hope is there for sovereign power and civil peace? Now, however successful one judges them to be, the thrust of Hobbes's scriptural arguments is clearly deflationary. He affirms the broad outlines of Christian apocalypticism while attempting to interpret away its radical message in order to ensure the conditions of a stable political order. But Hobbes's attempt to combat the radical apocalypticism of his day, I suggest, extends even beyond these overtly scriptural arguments in the last half of Leviathan. And so in this final section of my remarks, I'll make the case that both the rhetorical techniques and the narrative features of Hobbes's secular political argument in the first two parts of Leviathan resonate with 17th century apocalypticism, the core plot of which sees world-shattering violence as a necessary prerequisite to salvation and enduring peace. And Hobbes's innovation, I suggest, was to redeploy and redirect the radical apocalypticism of his day and to put it once again in the service of sovereign power. And he does this in part by offering a captivating vision of a secular apocalypse in which the terror of the state of nature is the narrative prelude and the necessary prerequisite to the creation of an orderly and enduring commonwealth. Now, this secular political project begins with his account of the state of nature, the condition in which men find themselves in the absence of political authority. And I tend to think Hobbes's familiar, perhaps too familiar, description of this condition still merits our close attention. And I'm quoting him. In such condition, there is no place for industry, because the fruit thereof is uncertain, and consequently no culture of the earth, no navigation, nor use of the commodities that may be imported by sea, no commodious building, no instruments of moving or removing such things as require much force, no knowledge of the face of the earth, no account of time, no arts, no letters, no society, and, which is worst of all, continued fear and danger of violent death, and the life of man, solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. Now, like the threatened apocalypse that haunted his life and work, Hobbes's state of nature is a chaotic, it's a terrifying moment in which all mankind is driven by, as he puts it, a perpetual and restless desire of power after power that ceaseth only in death. It's a violent rupture in the temporal continuity of history, a state of war in which there is, as he puts it, no account of time. The biblical apocalypse is the rupture between our worldly life and the eternity of Christ's kingdom. Hobbes's state of nature is the rupture between the life of a political order that is dissolved and the creation of an enduring Leviathan state. But notice, too, how in describing this natural condition, Hobbes rhetorically performs an apocalyptic uncreation. All of the markers of worldly and material existence are called to mind only to then be rhetorically annihilated. No place for industry, no navigation, no commodious building, no letters, no society. The repetition of "there is no" produces a sort of paradoxical effect, makes all of these features of worldly life powerfully present for us, only to then obliterate them in the mind's eye. Hobbes asks us to imagine a commonwealth in ruins, feat that would have been all too easy for those who lived through the Civil War. His description of the state of nature focuses as much, I would suggest, on the annihilation of the material features of our common life as it does on the barbarous condition of natural man. I also want to suggest that if we attend not only to the premises, but also to the plot, to the narrative structure of Hobbes's argument, we see that the state of nature serves as a narrative prelude to the establishment of the Leviathan state. Now, in a relatively straightforward sense, it's the experience of the horrors of the state of nature that drives individuals to subject themselves to a virtually absolute sovereign. And the Leviathan state that emerges and that is so powerfully represented in the work's iconic frontispiece is, in its origins, its form, its powers, and perhaps even in its visual representation, a secular mirror image of Hobbes's account of the kingdom of Christ in the last chapters of Leviathan, something I'm happy to talk more about together. But there's another way in which the apocalyptic violence of the state of nature provides the necessary prerequisite for the enduring peace of the Leviathan state, and it's not as a narrative plot device, but rather as a rhetorical and imaginative tool whose invocation elicits the salutary fear of violent mortal death that is necessary for the stability of the Leviathan state. Now, in order for the Leviathan state to provide a stable solution to the problems of the state of nature and civil war, its sovereign representative must use coercive power and punishment to, as Hobbes puts it, bridle men's ambition, avarice, anger, and other passions. Now, the effectiveness of the Leviathan state in securing peace through obedience depends crucially, then, on the primacy of our fear of violent mortal death. Of course, by the time he wrote Leviathan, as we've seen, Hobbes was not all that confident that this fear could be depended upon to emerge on its own and to override other fears and passionate desires. So while he often wants to suggest that the fear of death is our most basic and reliable fear, and indeed the political argument seems to depend on this, Hobbes worries that, and I'm quoting him again, the fear of darkness and ghosts, religious fears, is greater than other fears, end quote. Now, if successful, Hobbes's deflationary account of the final judgment and hell would go some way to diminishing our religious fears of darkness and ghosts or things invisible. But our earlier analysis of this account suggests some reasons to doubt his full success on this score. Now, to make matters worse, not only might the Leviathan state have to contend with those subjects whose souls have not been soothed by Hobbes's revisionist account of hell, it will also have to deal with those willing to risk their lives for the sake of honor and glory. No matter how costly the Leviathan state makes disobedience, Hobbes acknowledges that there will always be some willing to bear these costs. What is more, the number of such risk acceptance subjects will tend to increase the longer the peace and security of the Leviathan state endures. For as Hobbes points out, the subjects willing to strive for honor and preferment are, quote, those who are least troubled with caring for necessary things, end quote. Freed from the persistent threats of violent and premature mortal death in the state of nature, and made comfortable by an effective regime of enforceable law, men's concern with honor and reputation becomes comparatively more powerful. And Hobbes gives us little reason to think that the relative salience of religious fears and worries about the ultimate fate of one's soul might not gather similar strength over time in an effective and peaceful commonwealth. Now, several interpreters of Hobbes have emphasized the role of enlightened education or cultural transformation as strategies for diminishing the strength and political effects of these motivational threats. It seems reasonable to conclude that if such strategies are to succeed, they must be complemented by an effort to inflame the fear of violent mortal death that is always at risk of being weakened in a prosperous and secure state. Now, one way of doing this is by rhetorically invoking the apocalyptic horrors of the state of nature and civil war, casting them as perpetually imminent possibilities. And if Hobbes intended, as he suggested, that Leviathan be read and used by sovereigns and taught in universities in order that preachers and the gentry might be equipped to sprinkle the book's civil and moral doctrine upon the people, it seems plausible that he saw the work not only as a source of arguments that might be redeployed in a more secular context, but also as a rhetorical example of how to harness and redirect apocalyptic images and narratives. And I would suggest that Hobbes's own terrifying description of the state of nature could serve as a model for the redirection of the apocalypticism of his day for the purpose of eliciting the kind of salutary fear required to secure obedience and maintain the peace and prosperity of the Commonwealth. I think I'll leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you, Alison. Jonathan Bruno is going to offer initial commentary.
Great. So first of all, I just want to thank Professor McQueen very much for coming out to present this paper. I think it's a fantastic paper. I really learned a lot from it. And you know, it's difficult to write something original about Hobbes because the secondary literature is vast and also foreboding. And I think the lens that you bring to this very familiar text really sheds light on some aspects of the work that it's easy to miss. So I did learn a lot from it. I'm aware of the time, and we have a full house, so I'm going to be very brief. I just want to raise three points that occurred to me. So the first, you actually alluded to it very briefly in your comments, which is that the redefinition of hell goes along with a redefinition of heaven. Mm. And I just wondered if there was a reason why, other than space constraints, less emphasis was placed on that redefinition. Mm. Because initially, I thought that if the idea is that Hobbes is fighting apocalypse with apocalypse, as you say, the redefinition of heaven, it seems to me, is one sense in which that's happening, right? Yeah. At least in terms, the original meaning of apocalypse is about revealing the secrets of heaven. And that struck me as a very important part of the story. So just a question about that. The second question is, or observation is about your characterization of the secular project in the first part of Leviathan as a kind of harnessing of apocalypse. So the couple of places where I wasn't entirely sure that I was persuaded were these. So you mentioned at one point that the sovereign has to participate in a secular apocalypse. But it seems that in Leviathan, it's rather that the sovereign is ending the secular apocalypse, right? This this horrible state in which, as you say, the prospects for commodious living or security are absent. So the question, I guess, is really gets to your central point about whether this is in fact a redirection of apocalyptic thinking. When you first introduced that notion, you characterize apocalypticism as prophecy about the imminent end of the world. But in that sense, it seems straightforward that Hobbes wants to reject that kind of prophecy. It's right that the state of nature is sort of lurking in the background as the only available alternative to sovereignty. But it seemed to me that it remains the case that Hobbes really doesn't want that kind of fearful prophecy to flourish in the Commonwealth. The last observation or question is about how you see, and you touched on this a little bit at the end, but how you see the sort of doctrinal redefinitions going on in the text being related to his broader political project. So one of the really fascinating things about the way that Hobbes characterizes the sorts of preachers whom you quote in the paper is that a lot of them, he seems to think, are not actually sincere. That is, they don't really buy their own arguments. They're motivated by interest, really. They're motivated ambition. By ambition, yeah. Right? So he says in Behemoth, and though it be not likely that all of them did it out of malice, this is the Presbyterian preachers, right. Many of them out of error, yet certainly the chief leaders were ambitious ministers and ambitious gentlemen, the ministers envying the authority of bishops, whom they thought less learned, and so on. So he goes on at some length about that.
Yeah.
So the question is just whether, for Hobbes, even if we're successful in redefining and closing off these particularly dangerous doctrinal paths, don't we also need the institution of punishment and the regulation of speech, what he calls the government of doctrines, and these other types of sovereign activities, and the educational project that you mentioned at the end.
Right.
So it's really just a question about how you see that the use of these redefinitional techniques fitting in with these other aspects of his project.
Great. Thank you. I'll just say a few things, and then I'm looking forward to the discussion. So the chapter's gone through, as chapters do, a lot of changes in response to my own changes of mind, and helpful criticism from others. But on the first point, I think you're entirely right that more needs to be said about Hobbes's attempt to sort of redefine not only hell but also the Christian account of heaven and salvation. And I did gesture in the talk to I think part of what his strategy is there is to make heaven and salvation a lot more prosaic, right? You know, the ultimate kingdom of Christ is going to be sort of a kingdom like any other. The main difference is that you know, fewer means of coercion will be necessary because it will be men as they should be rather than men as they are. But really, it's a sort of kingdom like any other, and it's going to be on earth. And to be honest, the way the whole thing is described makes it sound pretty dull. And so we sort of get the, you know, hell, not so bad as you thought, heaven, not really as it's so much as it's cracked up to be. And I think you're just entirely right that more needs to be said about that in the paper. So I accept the force of that worry. Now, I think in your second comment, you pointed to, I think, something that's partly just some infelicitous wording on my part. This may be a remnant from some previous thinking. I'm not sure if I would want to hang so much anymore on the sovereign having to sort of participate in the apocalypse. What I would say is that I do think it's important that when Hobbes says that has this idea that the doctrine of the book might be taught in universities and might be offered as tools for preachers and the gentry so that they may sprinkle its civil doctrines, I think we want to be attentive to the fact that maybe what he's imagining these people sprinkling on the masses is not just some appropriately simplified version of the arguments offered in the book, but that maybe also that he envisions some of the rhetorical techniques being used in the book as something that might be available for sprinkling upon the masses. And I think there that the as you said, the state of nature that's always lurking in the background. One of the things I do want to insist upon is that I think that that effective, given the problems of the strengthening of passions like glory and honor in a stable and peaceful regime, given the difficulties of the power that these kinds of religious accounts of the apocalypse and the end times might hold on people, over people, I think that one of the things the sovereign and his agents are going to have to do is to present this terrifying account of the state of nature as a perpetual and imminent possibility. I mean, should we fail? Should we become too passionate? Should we be too invested in these sort of religious hopes and fears? There's always this danger of backsliding into a state of nature. And I think Hobbes does, at many points, portray this as a kind of backsliding. I mean, especially when he compares the state of nature to civil war, right? It's a perpetually imminent possibility unless the Leviathan state can sort of do its job. There's a lot more to be said about that, but I'll leave it there. Just on the third point, you're entirely right that he thinks that a lot of these preachers, apocalyptic and otherwise, were manipulative. They were motivated by ambition. He sort of says either they were manipulative, or they were madmen and delusional, right? I actually think the problem of the delusional ones is a more pronounced problem for him than the problem of the manipulators. And so I certainly don't want to suggest that some of the account I give of the secular project at the end is sort of things that the sovereign might take instead of processes of re-education and redescription of religious commitments. I think is sort of in addition to, and I'm not sure, given the extent of the problem of the religious beliefs and certain passions hold over us, that the re-education alone or the restrictions on speech are going to be sufficient. So that's more the worry, that strategy I outlined would be a supplement to and not a replacement for what other scholars have rightly identified as some of the educative and transformative work that a Leviathan sovereign would have to do. But thank you for the great comments.
Thanks to both of you. I'll maintain a cue if you could say your name and use the finger judiciously as a follow-up. Is that Rory?
Yeah. Rory Schachter. So I wanted to ask you about your claim, the end of your long footnote on page 3, that your argument is not logically, I'm quoting, is not logically inconsistent with any of the positions outlined above, positions being the views of Hobbes,
as an atheist, or, yeah.
Yeah, the positions you list, Skinner, Strauss, Johnston, about the major, almost all of the major Hobbes scholars the last 50, 60 years. And you say it's not logically inconsistent with any of these scholarly positions and could reasonably be held by any of their defenders, any of these scholars, as long as they accept that one of Hobbes' primary purposes was to investigate and secure the conditions of political order. Well, all Hobbes scholars, all readers of Hobbes agree that one of his primary goals was the securing of political order. So it seems like you're saying that your position, your interpretation of Hobbes on Apocalypse is consistent with all of these scholars. And you also say that it's not relevant, or if we can, it's orthogonal whether we view Hobbes, or one concludes Hobbes was a Christian, an atheist, an agnostic, or a deist, or whether one is agnostic as to which of these four was. But many of the scholars you list think that either not knowing which he is, or their view that he's an atheist or a deist, is fundamental to understanding his project, which includes this partly this redirection. And so I wonder if, you know, I personally find very interesting and want to know, in a way, what Hobbes' position was. If I say, well, I'm not sure, that's one thing. But it seems a different thing to say, I'm not sure, and it doesn't actually matter if we know or not, my position stands. So I wanted to give just two examples for me, which for me and for some of these scholars are significant questions about Hobbes' view of religion, which seem to involve trying to make us what kind of person.
Good.
But first, internal to the text, you talk about secular apocalypse, that's the state of nature, and then the sort of theological apocalypse that he apocalypses that he discusses. Now, I wonder, you know, what right do you have to the word secular apocalypse? For example, Rousseau observes that the state of nature doctrine can very easily be taken to be anti-biblical, because in Genesis there is always a power to keep you in awe, namely God. And he's at pains to say that his account is hypothetical, because a state of nature teaching seems on the face of it anti-biblical. So there's a tension, and you know, you say secular apocalypse, but you know, to my mind, a state of nature sounds more, could be like a civil war, like in Corcyra and Thucydides. There's no apocalypse in Thucydides, it's just disorderly, it's horrible. But to conclude that the state of nature is the worst thing seems to mean that it seems to ask, well, isn't hell worse than the state of nature, Corcyra? It seems like eternal damnation is worse than what happened in civil wars. So that's sort of one internal problem. The second is on the external, or the rhetorical political effect, which is, if he has this project for the redirection of apocalypse, did he succeed? And what I mean is, and I don't really know the answer, but compare him to Locke just for a second. Locke influenced and had many theologians and priests who became, if not strict Lockeans, you know, viewed his teaching as influential. They were even happy to give him as an authority after a while. Are there any examples in Hobbes' time or shortly thereafter where Hobbes convinced theologians to redirect their apocalyptic or tone down theologies in his direction? I mean, my impression, not knowing the literature that well, is he offended everyone,
yes,
and he was a complete failure, or he seemed to be a kind of failure in this regard, which begs the question, A, was his project what it was, and it was a failure, which means one would wonder why he was such a failure. Or B, you know, was that his, can we think of it as this direct influencing people? And because it just nobody really seems to have accepted his account of the afterlife at face value. It seemed to, as far as I understand it. So I don't understand, was his redirection then a flaw, or what was happening?
Okay, good. Thank you. I mean, I think you're right. Let's take footnote 4 to start with. I think you're right, Rory, that a lot of the scholars listed here would say that it matter. Our judgment about what Hobbes's own beliefs and commitments were matters to our interpretation of his project. Now, I have to say that part of the motivation behind footnote 4 comes, for me at least, from a certain frustration with how much the literature on Hobbes's scriptural arguments has been focused on trying to pin down what beliefs he himself actually held. And part of my frustration with this comes with a sense that we're never going to be able to reach any kind of firm conclusions on this point, partly just from the usual difficulties of inferring from a text we have what its author in fact actually sort of was committed to in the depths of his soul. I would say that I think that the most promising line of investigation, if we're going to infer beliefs from textual evidence, is actually some of what Quentin Skinner has suggested in the Reason and Rhetoric book that happily, I think, and unusually for him, aligns him with others who suggest that there's this sort of esoteric project at work in Hobbes's scriptural argument, which is to, once we know about the kind of education, humanist education Hobbes received in the use of rhetoric, and we know what kinds of techniques he would have been familiar with, to then find in his scriptural arguments the use of such biting irony, etc., suggests that he wasn't in any way a sincere or at least an orthodox believer. And I think there's some productive lines of investigation there. I still think, though, that, I mean, I still sort of stand by what I say in footnote 4. I think that all you have to be committed to in order to accept an argument that he found these apocalyptic ideas troubling and that he would have had an interest in redirecting them is just to accept that he wants to secure the basic foundations of political order and civil peace, and that we, I think the argument can go through even if we don't have, even if we haven't reached a conclusion about his own beliefs. Now, I think you two have maybe pointed in your first point about what right do I have to the word secular, to a slight uncarefulness in some of my wording. I tend to like the term seemingly secular a little bit more that I've used at points in the paper. But you sort of folded in an additional concern into that question that I think was pressing on the description of the state of nature as apocalyptic. Right? Isn't it just a bad thing? Isn't it? And as we know, a lot that some of the way in which Hobbes talks about the state of nature is perhaps, or at least plausibly, connected to the account of the civil war in Corcyra as a translator of Thucydides. You know, that those kinds of resonances are there. I would again just say that I think that there are two ways in which it sort of this account of the state of nature partakes of the apocalyptic. One has to do with its sort of placement in the temporal argument, right? The violence and chaos of the state of nature becomes a sort of necessary prerequisite to this orderly kingdom of the Leviathan state. But also in the way I sort of highlighted in response to the comments as well, that it may be that an effective Leviathan sovereign has to cast that kind of backsliding into a state of nature as a perpetual and imminent possibility. So we don't want to hang too much on it being exactly like the biblical apocalypse or something. I maybe want to say something a bit looser, that it partakes of the apocalyptic. Now, how successful was Hobbes in his redirection? I think there may be people in this room who can answer this a little bit better than I can, who know a bit more about the reception of Hobbes. I don't think he was a complete failure, but certainly his attempt to convince theologians was substantially marred by other lines of argument in Leviathan that were, you know, the cause for a lot of objection and accusations of heresy. So in a way, some of these other arguments, especially ones that seem to suggest that Moses was a member of the Trinity, might have sort of prejudiced his chances for success from the get-go, right? Now, as I briefly alluded to in my comments, he also takes back some of his account of hell and damnation. But I think there are other lines of scriptural argument that pose such a problem for people. I think they prejudiced any chance of him being convincing, fully convincing on other fronts as well. Though other people are, you know, I'm not gonna, you know, stand by that vehemently. But anyway, let's.
Eric.
See, and I usually wait. I assume when I was putting my hand up, there must already have been 12 people. Okay. I think it's a fascinating paper. I have a lot of thoughts about it, but just two. One is a little point that comes out of the exchange you just had, which is the passage from chapter 17 that you read out. You know, the description of the state of nature. And particularly, there's no industry because the fruits thereof are
13.
Uncertain. Yeah, excuse me, 13.
Yeah.
In the paper, it was interesting because you cite a passage from Thucydides, mm-hmm. from later in the Thucydides translation on war,
mm-hmm.
Right after that. But that passage is actually a pretty substantial paraphrase from the Thucydides,
mm.
from book one of the Archaeology. And the line in particular, that line, that there's no cultivation of the earth because the fruit thereof is uncertain, is just translating from Thucydides, which I think is interesting, you know, that there's a sort of a classical source from which
right.
he's drawing that.
And a pre-Christian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I guess that's a sort of a little thing that gets me to my bigger thought, which is about the... I was trying to get clear in my own mind how I should think about the two ways in which the argument is running. I mean, that is, so on the one hand you have him sort of politicizing the apocalypse, and then on the other you have him apocalypticizing politics.
I like that.
And the question is, once you've done the first, in the way that you think he has, and I agree with you, then how much significance can we attach to the fact that his politics begins to look quite a lot like what would happen in the apocalypse? I mean, if you've recharacterized the apocalypse so that all it is just
politics,
God coming and ruling
right.
as a civil sovereign over people who don't die, then the fact that the civil sovereign, you know, rules, you know, Crozier and Sword over, you know, people who don't die, it looks like the apocalypse, but that's only because the apocalypse has been made to look like politics already. So it was sort of just a broader question about the, you know, the argument about how much we really want to sort of double down on the claim that he's infusing his description of his own politics and political theory with the imagery of apocalypse. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it? It could be that since you're so persuasive that the other way around is happening,
then it's not so surprising
yeah.
that yeah.
So that's point number one, and then point number two is, in a way, this gets. I'm very sympathetic to what you said in response to Rory's question, because I think there certainly we can at the very least talk about the role that these different claims play in the argument, and the things he's able to achieve with them, without necessarily taking a position on. You know, how convinced he was by the claims he was offering. But, well, and you know I would say something like this, but I think part of the, but there's a kind of background or shadow sense in which the plausibility, so when you start, when people, not you, because you're very careful about this, but when people start saying, well, this argument is designed to do X, right? I mean, so the argument is, the argument about hell is designed to make it so that people fear their sovereign more than, sort of punishment in the next world. Putting it that way is at least potentially question begging. Right?
Yeah.
That is, it assumes that that's the way that it's going, rather than the other way around. Right.
Right.
And that and part of that move seems to me always to sort of piggyback on the thought that this is absurd, right? That it's just bizarre. That these are kind of implausible ways of thinking about. The relevant issues, that is just sort of kooky and...
that his account of hell
yeah,
is
well,
kooky.
All of
yeah,
it, yeah the sort of whole bit, as you say, you know, making hell seem not terrible, making heaven seem not so great, making, you know, sort of doing all of this. And that's the piece that I do wonder about, because here he's not alone. I mean, there's a huge number of people who are trying to go back to what they consider to be a much more scriptural understanding of eschatology, and they're going back and they're sort of noticing perfectly straightforward things like you know, there is no mention of the immortality of the soul in the Hebrew Bible.
Yeah.
In the Hebrew Bible, people die. There's no mention of the resurrection in the, of any resurrection in the Hebrew Bible until the you know well, depending on how you cut the deck, Ezekiel or Daniel. But you know, a lot of the, you know, so there is this school of thought that's worrying people like Calvin, who attacks it in the Institutes, right, who says, you know, this business that the kingdom of God is a terrestrial kingdom is a Jewish heresy.
Right.
That we have to get away from. You know, these are people who sort of going and they're deciding that actually the problem is when everything became Greek. Right?
Yes.
And that here
yeah.
we had this perfectly good scriptural account where there is a you know, people die and then there's a resurrection of the body, and that actually not only is that not necessarily connected with an idea of the immortality of the soul, but there's a certain obvious sense in which their intention, right? I mean, the idea of a resurrection seems to presuppose you're really dead, right? Not that some piece of you isn't. You know, one, if you take seriously that he has this agenda, then he has to say what he says about hell, he has to say what he says about
yeah.
heaven, he has to say what he says about all of this stuff. Sort of taking view that I think you're perfectly right to hold on to the thought that we don't need to settle all of this in order for you to make the extremely good points you make. I do wonder whether there's a certain underlying sense that all of this is just silly and therefore obviously instrumental in some way,
that there's an underlying sense in my
yeah.
yeah
no, no, no,
or
no,
just
in
general
the, in the ether yeah
right
yeah.
Okay. Super. And the point about book one of the archaeology is well taken, so I'll just accept the force of that. Now the first point on, you know, that maybe what by the time we get to his what I call his we'll add the seemingly secular strategy in the last bit of the paper that maybe that finding isn't all that surprising given what he's been up to in the scriptural section. I mean, I think this is true for several elements of Hobbes's scriptural strategy. So, for instance, in the interesting treatment he has of Moses, which you know a fair bit about, this strange appropriation of Moses, rather than say one of the Davidic kings, which might have been an easier road for him, but the appropriation of Moses as sort of prototype or biblical exemplar for the Leviathan sovereign requires all this interpretive maneuvering, right, to find a moment where the Israelites consent to Moses's political or civil authority, right? He locates that moment of consent in the moment in Exodus when they say, you know, you go speak with God, for we will not speak with him lest we die, etc. So there's all this sort of massaging of the account of Moses to turn Moses in to something like a proto-biblical exemplar of a Leviathan sovereign. And then there's also a lot of ways he has of talking about the Leviathan sovereign himself, as sort of, especially in the last half, as a sort of sovereign prophet, right? And so he does this there too. He sort of, what he's doing is sort of massaging the analogy at both ends, right? He's giving us a more Leviathan-like Moses, and he's giving us a somewhat Mosaic Leviathan. And I think there's maybe something to be said for that strategy in what you've pointed to with the treatment of Apocalypse, right? On the one hand, you're exactly right. He's given us an account. And this is why your point about the necessity of talking about a sort of prosaic account of heaven is maybe important. You know, he gives us this very sort of, you know, the kingdom of Christ, the final kingdom of God is going to sort of be like a Leviathan commonwealth, but, you know, a bit better because we live forever and you know, it's only the good people who behave as they should who are left.
And don't have kids for the great.
Right, so they're neighbors. Super. But I think he's also giving us an account of the Leviathan state that is, he's sort of, again, sort of massaging the analogy at both ends, right? He's giving us a sort of political account of the afterlife and maybe giving us a somewhat scripturally infused or theological account of the politics. And so I don't think we want to abandon either side of the massaging of that analogy, even though I think maybe you're right about sort of the progress of the argument in the paper, that by the time we get to that last stage, we think, well, is this really that surprising? Now, I think you're right about the, to point two, I think you're right about the general trend of the scholarship and some of the ways of talking about Hobbes on hell, that there's some kind of a background assumption that this is all sort of kooky. And I think we should probably, for the reasons you suggest, we should resist that. It's not all that kooky for the time, right? There are a lot of people going back and looking at these arguments. And, if you want visual proof that people had in mind, or at least some people were captivated by an idea of bodily resurrection, just go to the chapel at Orvieto and look at the Signorelli Apocalypse on the walls of that chapel. There are, you know, people and skeletons crawling out of the earth at the point of resurrection, right? This is not a crazy or kooky idea. There would be a bodily resurrection. So I think you're right to point to, as a contextual matter, he's not being all that loopy here. The whole thing about the propagation of the children of the damned, I think that's pretty loopy. Maybe you could answer this better. I haven't seen any contextual precedent for that, although Chris might know more about this too. But let's leave it there and press on.
Well, Chris is next.
Okay, Chris,
I've been trying to imagine what he's gonna say in light of his paper last semester, and
right.
We'll see.
in light of what we were just saying, I mean, I would just reiterate that, I think that even in a world in which people had a lot of very, very strange ideas about hell, Hobbes' ideas of hell were more bizarre, and I think that he knew they were going to be more bizarre, and they were more controversial. I think that it would be very hard to find something that wasn't more controversial. It didn't stand out as much in the cats and
the house. Can I just ask, I mean, I know you've thought a lot about this. Is it, what parts do you think are the most controversial? I mean, I've always taken the point about the damned propagating, and that's what allows the fires of hell to be eternal, to be the strangest. But
Well, I think that people, the most interesting and powerful critiques, don't actually engage him on those very specific instances. They take those as examples of the fact that Hobbes is simply not serious, and that his only goal there is to try to make hell seem like it's not a very bad place. That's what they really found. That's what they really found very, very offensive. And I think that is odd. I think it's clear that that is his strategy, and that in itself is very bizarre, regardless of all the specific details. And on those details, I think if you look at the text also, it's very hard to pin down exactly what he really thinks. I mean, he shifts back and forth talking about the effect of fire on people, and he says, well, there is no fire. It's very hard to figure out what he's trying to do, or what he's saying. He's so equivocal about it in a way that he isn't in a lot of other theological positions that it's hard not to think that he wants to just leave you confused. Without going into it in great detail, I think there's a lot of evidence that he knew that this was going to be extremely controversial. Right? He says on the first page of Leviathan that this isn't going to go over well. It wouldn't have been a surprise to him that this was going to happen. But I guess I just wanted to go back actually to what I was going to say, which was just to maybe ask for a point of clarification on something Rory brought up. It did seem to me that the premise of your work is that Hobbes isn't really interested in the truth of these biblical matters. He's interested in diffusing a specific political problem.
Yeah.
And that seems to be very strong evidence that he is not really a believer, and that whatever he's trying to convince people of, it's not what he regards as the truth of Christianity. Would you say that's correct? That that's the premise, that he's really not after the truth. He's after a specific outcome.
He's got a political and polemical strategy,
you would
read the fact that he's not so interested in the truth of these doctrines itself as evidence that he can't have been a sincere or standard believer. Is that what I take you to be saying?
Well, if he was a very sincere believer and he was trying to convince people of things that were not the truth of Christianity, that would be really troublesome.
Yeah, I mean, he has a couple places where, and I think one of them maybe in Behemoth actually, where he says it can't be that Scripture tells us anything that's not true, right? And he goes on to sort of say, that the suggestion is, as I recall at least, that Scripture could not be possibly telling us anything that would not be in line with the requirements of political obedience and a stable state. Now, that may all just be window dressing, right? But I think he does seem to think that there is some kind of true way of interpreting Scripture, but that in fact that true way is to make what it says consistent with and not a threat to civil sovereignty. Now again, you might just say, to bear on Rory's and your point, that's just Hobbes trying to say something to soothe potential believers and to deflect worries about his own commitments or charges of heresy. Turns out, if that was the intention, he wasn't at all successful, right? He's the poor man's fighting off charges of heresy left, right, and center. But I take your point. I think that's a good way to put it, though, that if I want to insist that Hobbes is less interested in the truth of these doctrines than he is about in their political effects, then shouldn't we read that as some indicator of his own beliefs? I think is the best way to put that criticism. So I'll have to think about that. I know from reading your really interesting and careful work on Hobbes and hell that your own argument is that Hobbes knew that his account of hell would be confusing, and in fact the entire intention of the account is to sow doubts in people's minds about the possibility of hell. And I think that's a reasonable argument to make. I'm not as convinced as you that he knew that the account would be confusing. Part of that has to do with, I think, I side a little bit more with the kind of perspective that Eric has offered, that there were several elements of that account that were less strange and kooky than they seem to contemporary eyes. One way of making sense of some of the places where Hobbes's scriptural arguments, the account of hell included, is sort of inconsistent, is to say that maybe, in fact, the purpose is not to offer us an entirely consistent account of scripture, but to sort of give us multiple lines of argument, right? So that if we don't accept one, we can accept another, right? I mean, you might look at the whole strategy of scriptural argument that way. I mean, in Elements of Law and De Quive, Hobbes's main agenda is to just make the case that the requirements of salvation coincide with the requirements of obedience. And yet by the time he gets to Leviathan, the whole argument about hell seems to be premised on the idea that some people are not going to accept that argument, right? That you wouldn't have to offer a deflationary account of hell if you thought everyone would be persuaded by your argument that the requirements of faith coincide with the requirements of obedience. And it may be there are certain strands of his scriptural argument that we should read in a similar way, right? That he intended not to offer a consistent line of argument, not because he wanted to sow doubts in our minds or make us confused, but because he's just sort of throwing as many possible lines of argument at us as possible. I mean, law students have a way of talking about this strategy, the argument and the alternative, right? Offering several mutually incompatible lines of argument. So that's another way to look at it, but I'm not wedded to it, and I'm not fully convinced that your own way of reading Hobbes on hell is not the right way. Just to contrast the statement you pointed to at the beginning of Leviathan, where he sort of says, you know, you're not all going to buy these scriptural arguments. This is maybe not going to go over so well, and you're right about that. It's in strange contrast to something he says right at the almost at the breaking point of Leviathan between the secular argument and the scriptural ones, where he says, "Look, I've given you this argument about virtually absolute sovereignty. I've given it to you from I've given you an account based on reason." And he says, you may not buy this argument. You may say, when has such a commonwealth ever been known to exist, right? And he says, well, he has this sort of architecture metaphor. Well, architects draw up plans for buildings that have never been known to exist, but in some way we can still talk about them as true. And but he says, even if this argument of mine from reason is not persuasive, I am absolutely sure that it is an argument from the authority of Scripture, as I will go on to show in my account of the kingdom of God under Moses. And so it's an interesting contrast between the initial statement at the beginning of Leviathan that suggests this is, you know, as you say, this may not go over too well, with this, you know, declaration of real certainty that even if the philosophical argument is not going to go through, he's absolutely sure that it can be grounded in the authority of Scripture. It's not to, I don't think it in any way defeats your point. It's just an interesting contrast.
I want to give Chris the follow-up, but let me just add to my own to preface that. I mean the dedication where he feigns, I don't know how the world will receive this, right, is hard to reconcile with this acknowledgement of some of the metaphysics that might be a problem. But I also wonder whether there might be a little more disagreement here in the sense of two kinds of insincerity you can impute to Hobbes. You can say that he's working from premises that surely he doesn't accept all the premises, but he thinks that what he's producing is a valid sort of building structure. You could also think that so there's unsoundness, but validity. But I think the stronger claim I took you to be making is that at times he is actively proffering invalidity. Mm. He knows this conclusion does not follow. And I wasn't sure if Alison wanted to accept that second. I would view that as a stronger claim about what he's doing and how he understands the project.
That's a really helpful clarification, Eric. The truthful answer rather than a sort of performative answer is I'm not sure whether I want to accept that stronger claim. And I think maybe a bit of my wavering in response to Chris reflects some of that. Mm-hmm. But that it's a really helpful reconstruction of the what's at issue here, and thank you.
Sure. Well, let me see if Chris can.
Yeah.
I don't want to belabor all this, so we'll talk about it after, but I would just ask, again, to reiterate what Rory brought up. I mean, how do you account for the fact that despite having all these multiple layers of argument, they were just totally rejected by everybody? And don't we have to think that he was naive or a failure or a man who'd already gotten in trouble with his writing of De Kiwe falls into such a terrible trap with his next book? And how do you account for that?
Yeah, well, and a man who, when pressed on the on what many took to be the appalling, at least from a royalist perspective, the appalling doctrine of the sort of foundations of government in De Kiwe, when pressed, forget who it was who said, Eric would know this, who saw the page proofs of Leviathan and said, this is horrifying, why did you write this? And Hobbes said, well, the truth is I have a mind to go home, right? And the idea that he was trying to write an account that would sort of endear him to the new regime in England. And of course, that was a complete failure as well. But I realize part of what we have to reach a conclusion on, and that I haven't, and partly because it's a painful one, is you're pushing me to say, either Hobbes had an agenda that was a complete failure, both on endearing himself to the new regime in England, but also in offering scriptural arguments that would provide some kind of sound foundation for his political principles. So either we acknowledge that he's a failure, or we have to acknowledge, as you're putting it, that he had an additional agenda and that he wasn't a sincere believer. I think that's a good way of putting the difficult choice we're faced with here. And I suppose I lean a little bit to the first option, actually, that he had an agenda, and he it was something of a failure.
Michael.
Well, just on this point, before we classify Hobbes as a failure, I think we need to think a little more long term.
Good.
It's striking how similar this theology is to large swaths of Christianity today.
Yeah.
And not just in the discomfort with hell being that bad, although his particular solution may not be a popular one, but the materialism, the emphasis on bodily resurrection rather than immortality. You turn to your Seventh-day Adventists, your Mormons.
Right.
You're going to find lots of this sort of thing. And not coincidentally, they, at least now, maybe coincidentally, tend to be pretty obedient citizens. I'm not sure if there's a connection there. There might or might not be. But that sort of ties in to what I originally intended to say, which is that I think we need to distinguish more strictly between apocalyptic in the capital A sense of interpretations of the Book of Revelation and Christian eschatology, and apocalyptic in the lower A sense, apocalyptish. things that are kind of like things we might be thinking about when we're thinking about the end of the world, broadly speaking. And especially given the tensions Eric had already pointed out, that Hobbes's interpretation of the Book of Revelation makes it look rather unapocalyptic in the colloquial sense
right.
of the word apocalyptic.
Right.
Those two can come really quite far apart. And I was wondering whether you were dealing with capital A or lowercase a apocalypse
Good.
In the other two parts
right.
of the book. My guess would be in Machiavelli, you're dealing with capital A apocalypse, and with Morgenthau, because you're dealing with nuclear annihilation and not, the beast and the Horror of Babylon and stuff like that. You're dealing with lowercase a apocalypse. Not only do I worry, as a atheist Jew constantly concerned with the extinction of humanity, I worry that uppercase A Christian apocalypse may have very little to do with lowercase A apocalypse. But I think uppercase A apocalypse, to give credit where credit is due, is incredibly politically important. And I'm wondering if there's a missed opportunity here in the larger project, if when you get to the 20th century, you stop talking about capital A, apocalypse.
Right.
And I mean, it's not just the general Rousseauian problem of trying to be co-citizens with people who think you're damned, which is a more general problem having less to do with the hermeneutics of the Book of Revelation. But having this particular book accepted by the majority of a populace in a given polity as scriptural truth creates huge political problems, and does so right here and now. Things having to do with the sources of evangelical Zionism and philo-Semitism, the creepiest way a Jew can be loved. Things having to do with anti-environmentalism and a refusal to think long-term in American politics right now, I think have a lot to do with capital A, apocalypticism. And I'm worried that, you know, of course you're counteracting this tendency to only think about the secular Hobbes seriously, but I think it's a mistake to think about most politics only being serious when it's secular. And I'd actually really like, and of course there's always people saying, write the book I'd like you to write, not the book you're writing. But I'd really like an exploration of how exactly these issues with the literal identification of who is the Antichrist, the literal prediction that we are living in the end times as described in the Book of Revelation, when that belief is held by a plurality, a majority, a unanimity, if that has ever happened, of the citizens of a polity, what that does to the politics of the polity. Because I think we're living in precisely such a polity right now, and maybe as a Canadian you escape that, but...
Well, I'm here.
Right. You're here, and it is the end times here.
A little less here than other places.
Right. Well, we are producing the end times in other places through our policies towards the places where these things are supposed to happen.
Okay. There's a lot there. Thank you. So let me take a stab, and we'll see if I can satisfy you on these multiple lines of concern. Now, you're right that there are aspects of Hobbes's account, Hobbes's eschatology, that have over the course of history ended up being ideas that have seemed substantially less kooky to people and that are currently taken on board. I don't know if we want to infer from that Hobbes himself was sort of successful in the arguments that he offered. But
I've actually gotten pamphlets from Seventh-day Adventists and Jehovah's Witnesses that go pretty weirdly deep into what you would think are arcane intellectual historical matters. I mean, I don't know as a matter of fact that reading the theological parts of Hobbes, but I'm trying to remember what random figure from the history of political thought played a significant role in the most recent thing shown through my door.
Okay.
But it was, you know, a figure we might hear in this room on occasion, but I mean, we should give the superstitious and enthusiastic more intellectual credit than we usually do. I think these are often very well educated.
I'm certainly not denying that. I would just say it's still for me an open question whether the fact that there are groups that now accept some aspects of these doctrines should itself be read as evidence of Hobbes's own success in this matter.
But wouldn't that be a sign of Hobbes's failure? Divine right still exists. He hasn't succeeded destroying a Christian politics.
Well, he wants a Christian politics. He wants his kind of Christian politics. With
an atheist kind.
Right. A materialist.
Atheist.
I'm glad there are some people pushing in the room, pushing on an atheist Hobbes, and maybe you'll just think it's hopelessly backward of me that I want to remain agnostic on that question. But
Hobbes didn't want to remain. Well,
you set him up for that.
I did want to get to Michael's point about the big A apocalyptic and the small A apocalyptish. Now, I realize this is such an annoying thing for someone giving a talk to do, is to refer to some previous part of the book that you all haven't read, and you're supposed to take my word for it that this has been addressed earlier. And so you can...
I just did a series of annoying things. Okay. Write the book I want.
But one of the things an earlier part of the book does is actually try and track how a lot of the imagery, the narrative plot structure, the rhetorical devices of the books of Daniel and Revelation become, we may not want to use this word, but become progressively secularized and still pop up in seemingly secular settings today. Now, part of it is, I take your point that it's not as if these religious accounts of the end times, these overtly Christian accounts of the end times, have lost their force today. But I do want to insist, and the chapter on Morgenthau and nuclear annihilation and a conclusion that touches on briefly some of the kind of rhetoric that is used by environmentalists in the climate change debate, takes hold of some of this narrative structure and some of the imagery of the Book of Revelation and uses it for immensely polemical and sometimes effective, sometimes not, purposes. And so, I don't think it's conceptual stretching to talk both about large A apocalyptic and small A apocalyptic as both variants of the same phenomenon. I think we want to be attentive to the way in which a lot of this kind of imagery and rhetoric persists in seemingly secular mainstream settings. So that, I mean, you gave the example.
Well, it's just saying the mainstream is secular is the
well,
is the
right? No,
assumption.
I see that, and it gets America. It gets yeah. back to yeah. it gets back to or connects to some of Rory's right concerns to have about the use of that word. But I want us to be able to recognize apocalyptic imagery and rhetoric, not only in, as you put it, some of the opponents of the environmental movement, right? I want us to be able to recognize elements of that kind of apocalyptic worldview among members of the environmental movement as well. And I mean, I don't think it's any mistake that Al Gore, in An Inconvenient Truth, right, selects some images of climate change that have strong biblical resonances, right? Now, it's true that things like floods and insect plagues, etc., are things that scientists say are going to be are effects of climate change. But I think there are a lot of things scientists say are going to be effects of climate change, and he's been very selective in what he focuses on. I don't think it's any mistake either that by the time he gets through the part of his slideshow that shows you all these, images of climate change induced disasters, that he says, and I'm quoting, "This is like a hiking tour through the Book of Revelation," right? And so one of the hopes of the book is that we come to recognize instances of apocalyptic rhetoric, not only in the places we think we are going to more familiarly find it, right, among contemporary evangelicals and religious believers, but also among the seemingly secular, right? So that's part of why I think the book is doing a bit of that conceptual stretching that had worried you or that had motivated your response.
Yes.
Professor McQueen, thank you so much for your talk. I really enjoyed it. I just had two brief questions.
Can you tell me your name?
Oh, yes, Tyler.
Tyler, thank you.
So my first question was, you mentioned that in the Latin version of Leviathan, Hobbes downplayed the redefinition of heaven and hell, and I was wondering why he did that. And the second question was, how original was his redefinition of heaven and hell? What sources, remote or proximate, might he have been drawing from?
Right. Okay, thanks. So the part of the account of hell that he thought better of by the time he got to the Latin Leviathan was precisely this point about the propagation of the damned. That does not, he excises that in the Latin Leviathan. And again, there may be a few people here, Chris might be one of them, who can speak to better than I can to that decision on Hobbes's part. But I'm also inviting you here, Chris. I'm not sure that, to my memory, wasn't one of the lines of argument that caused him the most trouble in terms of people, the thing about the propagation of the damned. I mean, he got in a lot more trouble for these arguments that seem to suggest, as I said earlier, that Moses was part of the Trinity, et cetera. And he did excise several passages that along those lines. So the reason why he excised the thing about the propagation of the damned is still, for me, I think, a somewhat open question. One might like to think he just thought better of it. It is one of the kookier lines of argument, I think, in the account of hell. How original is his account? I mean, as Eric suggested, there were other people working before Hobbes and in his time who had corporeal and mortalist accounts of the end of days. And there were other people, and this is partly an effect of the Reformation, other people looking back to the authority of Scripture and sort of saying, hey, wait a minute, I don't see, you know, evidence here for certain aspects of a sort of accepted vision of Christian eschatology of the time. And so I don't think we want to...
Also, a huge part of the attack on Aristotelian physics.
Right, exactly. And for Hobbes, tied to not just the worries about, general worries he had about the Greeks and the Hellenization of philosophy, but also worries, and this gets, I think, a little bit underplayed in readings of Hobbes, worries he had about about sort of the tendency toward allegorizing and multiple layers of allegory that he associated with this Catholic schoolman interpretations of the Bible. Right now, it's awfully convenient that when Hobbes is interpreting Scripture and he thinks we have a erroneous metaphorical understanding of it, as for instance in our understanding of the kingdom of God as not being an earthly kingdom, he says, no, interpret this literally. It's a real, actual kingdom. And then, of course, in other moments, and hell is one of them, everlasting fires? No, don't interpret that literally. Interpret that metaphorically, right? So he's awfully, it's awfully convenient in his insistence on which things are meant metaphorically and which are meant literally. But in general, he has a sort of hostility toward this style of biblical interpretation that he associates with as coming out of Greek philosophy that involves these sort of multiple layers of allegory, sometimes built up to, you know, I don't know, 10 different sort of stages of allegorization. But I think we don't want to overplay, I think, his originality in some of these aspects of his eschatology. I don't think it's thoroughly original. Though for some of the reasons Chris suggests, it was problematic in his time. But
well, I'm fortunate there's time for me to ask my question. I should warn you, this morning I was lecturing in Foundations of Political Theory, gave my opening Hobbes lecture, a tribute to the paper, that I was already bringing more eschatology in than I otherwise have in the past. I mean, that's a very clever framing effect, so we'll see how long it lasts over the years. But I wanted to ask, I mean, insofar as Hobbes is trying to, your picture, remove this asymmetry problem, right, that to make eschatological pictures safe for monarchy, I want to point out three distinctions, very simple ones, that you might draw between the sense in which the state of nature looks apocalyptic. So the first one, and these are all fairly basic, but the traditional apocalypse is an irreversible event. Of course, there's a sense in which people get saved, but the world has still ended in some crucial sense, and one can never go back. Obviously, the state of nature is something that we can, and in many cases do, escape from. We also return to.
There's this kind of cycling. Backsliding.
Right,
yeah.
And so I wonder how much that first feature makes them pretty different and raises concerns for the asymmetry problem, because now I've kind of altered the ratio between the two. Secondly, the collective character of anything involving apocalypse involves something that happens to us, whereas the state of nature can happen to a single person. They can be thrust out into it. They can imagine themselves in a state of nature while most of mankind is not in the state of nature. And of course, Hobbes has us, just we can look out at civil wars, we can look at fragments of the past, and at least that gives us access to it. And so in that sense, there's a collective versus individual element that make them separate. And finally, thirdly, and this kind of sets up the third part, is that I take it for Hobbes, I have very immediate deliberative access to the state of nature. That is, however horrific it is, he thinks it is readily imaginable, in part because we can look at nations and witness it sort of right before our eyes. And yet, and you may challenge me on this, I take it that that's not quite the same when we imagine, or at least we strive to imagine, a genuine apocalyptic setting. That there, we really lack access to it. We don't have anything to look out at and see it as a model. And he might even say, in response to some people who have stressed, rightfully, the strangest of it, that any... You know, we're talking about degrees of utter strangeness, and just even the most modest version of what the end of the world looks like is going to be incredibly difficult to vividly access. And so you might say, fine, mine is a little farther on the spectrum, but we've already gone way past the point of this is nothing like the state of nature in this conventional sense. And so just another way of showing how it's not denying that there's a sense in which the imagery is there, right, but it is a way of stressing, I guess, Rory's point that they look fundamentally different in some ways, and I think you can accept them in important sense.
Yeah, no, I think that, again, that's, you've offered a helpful series of distinctions, and it nicely ties back to Rory's comments. And I think perhaps my way of talking about the apocalyptic qualities of Hobbes's account of the state of nature betrays too much of a sense that there are no disanalogies there, and that's certainly not the intention. And I think it would be more appropriate to say, and again, to say that there are aspects of Hobbes's account of the state of nature, its sort of implotment, we might say, some of its rhetorical devices that partake of a sort of apocalyptic imaginary. But for the reasons you suggest are not, there are some disanalogies, as well as that we know that he also drew on some of this account of the state of nature from Thucydides. And I think the three distinctions you've offered there are helpful. Let me just talk about one of them, though. The first one, that the traditional apocalypse is irreversible, and yet he has this account of the state of nature as something we can always backslide into. I think that's entirely right, but I think we wanna say something about Hobbes, right? Which is, I think the state of nature sometimes is there as part of a linear teleological account, right? As being the necessary prerequisite to something where the end point is the establishment of a Leviathan state and an orderly regime. And I think at other points in the text, Hobbes stresses a lot more the sort of cyclical nature of this, or the possibility of backsliding that suggests that it is reversible. My tendency is to insist that that ambiguity about a sort of teleological line of argument that shares more with the biblical account of apocalypse and something more like a cyclical or backsliding argument, that ambiguity is there in Hobbes, and depending on what sort of where he is in the argument, he'll stress a linear account versus a, perpetual possibility backsliding account. But I think one of the things that distinction points to is that in my own treatment of that, in the final section of the paper, could stand to be a bit clearer, right? So when I talk about the Hobbes's account of the state of nature and the Leviathan state as partaking somehow of that kind of apocalyptic narrative, that would be the part where he's insisting on a sort of linear account, right? As the state of nature being sort of the necessary, the narrative prelude, if we want to talk like literature scholars, to the Leviathan state. Yet when I talk later about how it might be used as a rhetorical tactic by a Leviathan sovereign trying to combat these, dangerous and like, peace-endangering passions for glory and honor and reputation, as well as these fears of things invisible, when I stress that the Leviathan sovereign might use this account of the state of nature in this rhetorical way, casting it as a perpetual and imminent possibility, that stresses something more like a sort of backsliding idea. And so, again, that's a long-winded way of saying I think the ambiguity is there in Hobbes, but that I think you've pressed me in a way that suggests that the last section of the paper could do a better job flagging those two different ways in which Hobbes draws on the imagery of the state of nature. So thank you.
Before we thank Alison, I want to invite you to join us for refreshments outside. I want to remind you of future gatherings involving Adam Sandel, Robert Goldberg, Peter Stacey, and Jacob Levy. I want you to give me some credit for not having used the word snowpocalypse, even however tempting it has been. I violated that. I'm sure Alison has heard before with this hugely fascinating paper that for someone who spends a large portion of her waking life thinking about doomsday, she's offered us a sort of sanguine and remarkable presentation that didn't have any hint of the darkness that is so much of your thoughts are devoted to. So thank you so much, and we'll continue outside.
Thanks, Eric. That one.